reality is, I have needs, you have needs, we all have needs, and God is aware of all of this. And I want to let you know that experiencing God's presence leads you to experiencing your needs being met. And so I find the setup of today's praise and worship and what Pastor Doris just shared and Jennifer just shared, the lyrics of the songs and everything, kind of all point us to this place of, hey, sometimes life is stressful. Sometimes we go through things that are difficult, and sometimes those things are physical and emotional. Other times those things are financial. And a lot of times when it's physical or financial, it makes us want to pull our hair out and get a little stressed out, doesn't it? And so today I want to speak to that. I want to talk to you about a God who loves us and a God who provides for us. Amen? And so I want to talk about this idea of provision. And we actually began talking about moving into His presence, making things a place for His presence. And when we experience His presence, we talked a little bit about this idea that provision comes with His presence. And the very first simple truth that's worth repeating, so I'll put it up on the big screen for you, is this: His presence will help you to stop worrying. Those of you that were there last time heard this, you need to hear it again. Stop worrying. Look at your neighbor and say, stop worrying. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Not smack your wrist and say, stop it. Stop it, self. Stop worrying. It's worth repeating because it's a real temptation. There's a difference between being concerned and being worrying. And worrying is not healthy at all. It doesn't help us. Matter of fact, Jesus told His disciples four times in one passage. Not once, not twice, not three times. Four times in one passage, don't worry. He told them, don't worry about life, don't worry about clothing, don't worry about food, don't worry about tomorrow. He said, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. All these things be taken care of. All these things will be added to you. You don't need to worry about all the stuff that we worry about. What we should be worried about is, are we seeking first His kingdom? Are we seeking first His righteousness? Are we seeking after God? Because the reality is, what Jennifer said is so true. Fire reveals our faith, or it reveals the lack of faith. Because every time you get in the fire, if you're freaking out and crying, your faith isn't worth much. But let's sink in. And I'm not judging you for that. I'm not judging me for that. But I'm just saying that Jesus Christ sacrificed an incredible amount of torment, pain, and suffering. And He rose on the third day. And He ever lives to make intercession for us as our high priest. It cost God His only begotten Son, and that whosoever should believe in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And once we begin seeking Him, we're supposed to have this faith enough that is worth something. We all know what it's like to have things that are worthless. Have you ever had a coupon that was worthless? It had a face value, but when you got to the store, there was an exclusion. Come on, lady, come on, talk to me now. Have you ever had a gift card to a restaurant, but you got there and it had expired and it was worthless? Your faith doesn't come with an expiration date. It doesn't come with, what it comes with is the blood of God. It comes with the Word of God, and it's got to be on the inside of us. Amen? And so, listen, we need to build our faith, and we do that by experiencing His presence in our lives. So stop worrying. I want everybody to breathe in real deep through your nose. Hold it. Exhale through your mouth. Let's take a big chill. Just this. This whole world and all of the media in our world is engineered to cause you to freak out and to fret and to release all kinds of negative stress hormones in your brain and body. And what I want you to do is I want you to get to breathe in if you feel it. Breathe in right now. And let the Spirit of God breathe in you. As you hear the word, let the Spirit of God just come into you right now and be amplified in your life. But here's the fact I want to hear this, I'll share it again. If I really engage in His presence, worry cannot coexist with my life. If I really hang out with God, and I really worship God, and I really pray to God, and I just for a moment, my own way, my own handy way, understand I'm experiencing God, worry cannot coexist in that moment. And so for some of you, that's my prescription from the Holy Spirit, that you would take some time this week to seek His presence. And I guarantee if you authentically do that, you're going to testify. Pastor was telling the truth. It's true. Worry can't coexist with His presence. If you, without worry, you still might have some concerns. So I want to begin with a really could have concerns. So I want to address those concerns. I want to turn your attention again this week to Psalm chapter 16. Totally me in your Bibles, look on the screen, look on the app, and check it out. Here's what the word said in verse 7. It says this: I will bless the Lord who has given me counsel. My heart also instructs me in the night season. Oh, thank you, God. I have set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. That's that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego kind of thing that says, even if, come on. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will rest in hope. That's the opposite of worry. For you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life. And say this with me if you can see it. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And say, in your presence is fullness of joy. Heavenly Father, I come to you right now with strong energy. There's some folks that need to experience the fullness of joy. Let me experience the fullness of worry, the fullness of fear, the fullness of fretting. And God, it is healthy to be concerned and to be a good steward. And it can be overwhelming sometimes when we have physical needs or financial needs or other needs that just can be so seemingly insurmountable and so overwhelming. And so right now, God, we just pause. And we just pray together that your presence would saturate our hearts and our minds for this little bit of time we have together, and that we would indeed expect that there is fullness of joy. We will walk out here today assured that there is a God in heaven who loves us, and in his presence is all the provision that we need for every need that we have. In Christ's name, those who agree say, amen. In your notes, I want you to just put this in your spirit. His presence can calm your concerns and meet your needs. And so I hope everybody's feeling calm right now. If you're feeling calm, raise your hand up halfway. Just halfway. Not all the way. Just chill. This is chill, right? You know, just wave at your pastor. I feel pretty calm right now. Good. I want to share with you this topic and this idea of God meeting our needs as we experience his presence. As we mentioned, there's a place for his presence. I want to kind of hit this from three different angles. And just holistically, in a sense. And the first thing is this in your notes, you can write this down if you like. Is this true? As you remain faithful and obedient, his presence will supply everything that you need. And so we're going to start right here with being faithful and being obedient. Because my God is faithful, amen. But the question sometimes is, are we faithful and are we obedient? I was just talking to someone I loved yesterday, saying, you know, the biggest question you've got to answer is, what does obedience look for you like in X, Y, and Z? And only you can answer that, but you need to be found obedient to God in X, Y, and Z. And so we need to do that. As we are doing that, oh my goodness, we experience his presence, and in his presence displayed his provision. A great example of obedience is this widow in Zarephath. And I hope I'm saying that correctly. You can turn your Bible to 1 Kings chapter 17. I'll get there in a second. Many of you might know the story. For those of you that do not know the story, the bottom line is, a man of God shows up, and this widow is getting ready. She's got her bankrupter out, or she's got her Red Lobster cheesesteak mix. Come on, somebody. Come on, testify. Those are good. Amen? Glory. And she's fixing to make their last little dinner, their last little meal. And the man of God showed up and said, make us something. And she's like, man, I'm making our last meal. We're going to die. We're going to eat this and die. We got nothing. We're busted. We're broke. We're busted, disgusted. We got nothing. And for those who know the meal, what happened is that meal, that last meal, became the seed. It became, it turned into a bottomless bread basket. Hey, come on, somebody. I said a bottomless bread basket. Can I give a witness? Last meal ended up being a seed that turned into a bottomless bread basket. Why? Because she was faithful and obedient to what God was instructing to do in that moment. And that was a real challenging thing. That was a real difficult thing to do. To give not just out of surplus, but to give out of need. And not just out of your need, out of the last little bit that you got for your own need. God said, I want you to be faithful, and she was faithful. Elijah told her, I love this in the story, he said, do not fear, do not worry. As long as there's a drought in the land, as long as there is a recession in the land, as long as you will be faithful and obedient, God will supply everything that you need. He will take care of it all. Amen. He told her not to worry, not to freak out. And what happens is faithfulness and obedience, that calling in our lives to be faithful and obedient, it can oftentimes introduce us to the monster of fear. And fear is just false evidence appearing real. We've heard that acronym before. But fear comes in with an incident. It's often wrapped in a lie, that is, Satan's made of tongue. And fear has a mission. Fear wants to speak into our spirit so that we will not walk in obedience, so that we will not walk in faithfulness, but instead we will walk in fear. You can't walk in fear and faith at the same time. You can walk in faith and have a sense of peace, God, I'm trusting you, and that can be a really interesting experience. But what I've noticed is when I do that, I don't have fear. Instead, what I have is a lack of sight as to how God is going to be faithful. But I know that His Word is true, that He is not a man, that He should lie, that every promise is yes and amen to them that believe. I've never seen a time when God told someone to step out on faith and instead their fear was manifested. No, every time that they were obedient and faithful, God showed up to fulfill everything He said that He would do. Amen? And so faithfulness and obedience that brings out fear, but we need to just say, no, I'm not going to do that. Probably got to get back to the first premise of this whole message. Do not worry. Throw worry out. Get rid of it. It doesn't do you any good. Listen to what the Word said in 1 Kings 17, verse 15 through 16. So she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and he and her household ate for many days. The bread of flour was not eaten. Nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. So God was orchestrating all this. He's experiencing the presence of God as the man of God comes in. And everything he said came true. That house experienced the presence of the Lord. And though that presence was a bit invisible or manifested through a prophet named Elijah, with his presence came provision. Say that with me. With his presence came provision. Did she lack anything? Did that widow lack anything? No. Did she die? No. Did her boy die? No. Sometimes we're convinced that if we'll be faithful to God, we're going to die. Then if we're obedient to God, we're not going to make it. That house had a bottomless bread basket during a drought. Translation to 2023, translation today is, don't really care what the value of the dollar is, the value of the yen, don't care how many oranges they harvested in Florida this year, don't care how many eggs, or if you got to have Easter potatoes, see some nonsense about that. The bottom line is this, your house can have every need met if you will walk in faithfulness and obedience to God, amen? And so what that means is, what is faithfulness and obedience? Every day we need to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. We actually need to want to live for Christ. We need to read Galatians chapter 5 and take a look at that. We need to look into Ephesians chapter 6 and understand the warfare realm that we're in. We need to understand what the fruit of the Spirit is and try to exhibit those things in our life. We need to pursue God, amen. And then when God begins to teach us spiritual principles, we need to be obedient in what? One of those things, we do every week, we talk about tithing. This is an area of obedience. And some people like, I like what the preacher said the other night, some people try to make bargains with God. Well, I'll give God 3% to go into church, 50% of the time, and expect 100% of the blessings. God doesn't work like that. He doesn't make deals. He makes covenants. And He made a covenant through Christ, and since that time, all He's called us to do is be faithful and obedient to Him. He's not interested in your deal. He's interested in your 3%. He wants you 100% in for Him. Amen? And when you make Him first, and when you make Him the love of your life, all of a sudden, you'll take these steps of obedience, and you'll find out every single time that God is faithful. He's not a man that He should love. Amen? Are you with me, church? Do you still love me? Okay, then the altar invitation will include this. I want to pray for you to have an increased faithfulness, a capacity for your faithfulness and obedience in Christ to increase. Is that okay? I want my faithfulness and my obedience to increase. I hope you want yours to increase. I want to grow. And as we do that, I want to pray for miraculous provision. Because doing supernatural things leads to supernatural things. Did you hear that? I said doing supernatural things leads to supernatural things. You keep trying to do everything in your own strength, and you're only going to get what your strength can give you. But when you do things in His strength, and you do things His way, all of a sudden you get His strength, and you get His way. And tithing is supernatural. Carving out time to make sure that you worship God as a lifestyle. Come on now, that's supernatural. Get yourself and your family into the house of the Lord. If you got children, you know it's supernatural. You give here and you worship God. That is supernatural. Supernatural, doing supernatural things gives you supernatural fruit. What we want is we want shortcuts. We want everything quick, easy, and instant. We want an instant extra pot rate. But we just need to walk in faithfulness. So I just challenge you to say, God, help me to understand this with just one area in my life where I can grow in obedience and faithfulness to you. Help me to do something supernatural. You know, it could be supernatural just exhibiting the fruits of spirit, man, that could have raised your work. Come on now, don't raise your hand. I'll even look away. Some of you work with people that just cause you to want to have a fit of rage. Not here. Thank God. But I've been in those environments, and I still know some of you might be in those environments. And for what you say to God, I want to help me to be faithful and obedient. I want to reflect the light that I heard about earlier. I want to reflect your image in this world. So God, help me this week to tame my tongue. Jennifer is trying to market and develop and brand a, what do you call it, tongue rattle. It's hard. The Bible says it's unruly. It's hard to tame. That's why I need the Holy Spirit. Amen. But just say, God, help me. Just whatever that area is, I'm telling you, that'd be a supernatural experience for you to get through that and watch God begin to provide things that you can't do that He does. Amen. The widow couldn't do what God did. But only God could do that. Amen. So on the one hand, I just told you that we need to be faithful, we need to be obedient. If we do that and we experience God's presence and we're faithful, we're going to experience provision in His presence and obedience. So, I want to blow your mind now. I'm not advocating that we be disobedient. I'm not advocating that we be faithful. I'm not advocating that we murmur against God. I don't think we should sin to disgrace the banks. But I'm going to share something with you that surprised me. And it's this, even when we are wayward, if we return to His presence, we will find God's abundant supply is waiting for us. Did you hear me? Even when we are wayward, if we return to His presence, we will find God and we'll find His abundant supply waiting for us. But Jesus talked about this. He did an amazing parable on someone He called the prodigal son. It's an artwork done by just amazing. And it's the story of a young man who was so very wayward. It's like, Dad, you're rich. I want my inheritance now. And he went out and he said, okay, you don't want to work here no more? Don't want to get tired of the, you know, the farm life? You want to work? Okay, go ahead, Anderson. Went into the big metropolitan area and spent everything on the loose living and ungodliness and unfaithfulness. Wound up in a pig pen. That's why Skid Row. I mean, he lived a life that was wayward, way away from God. He was so hungry. His clothing and his skin was so dirty. He felt so low and so bad. He was so wayward. But one day he returned to his home. I want you to join me in praying that some wayward sons and daughters would return to the Father. Can you pray that way with me? There are some wayward sons and daughters that need to return to our Heavenly Father. And I just want you to hear this. Luke 15, check it out. And he arose and he came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion. And he ran and he fell on his neck and he kissed him. And the son said, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. And I am no longer worthy to He called his son. Listen to what Jesus said to his servant. But the father said to his servant, bring out the best robe and put it on. Put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And bring the fatted calf here and kill it. And let us eat and be merry. For my son that I thought was dead is alive again. He was lost and is found. And then he began to be merry. Even when we're wayward, if we will return to his presence, we will find abundant supply waiting for us. You see, what the prodigal learned is this. The father has a heart that desires to restore. The father's heart wants to bless and to restore. We have a world that wants to say, I've got you. Be gone, the news. This terrible tragedy. It comes to you and going up all over the place. God says, I want to restore you. I want to love you. I want to heal you. I want to put your authority for you. I just want to bless you. He was broke. He was hungry. And his needs were met with abundance. And I love it. What we don't see here is kind of interesting is we don't see that the Father said, wait, before I put on that really nice robe on you, how about that tell you? Get cleaned up. Each day, brush your teeth, get cleaned up. He just put a robe on. What if we did that to lost people? What if we tell lost people, you don't got to get cleaned up to come to God? You come to God to get cleaned up. You just come to God and we'll just wrap our arms around you. We'll love you. We'll teach you about the authority of the ring. Come on, somebody. We'll talk to you about the how this love wraps around you. We're just going to love you. We're just going to celebrate that you're coming to God, that you were wayward and that you are here. Amen? And as we begin to celebrate, as we grow as a disciple, things are going to become up. Do you think it took very long for that prodigal son to walk with his dad and to realize at some point after he gets over the pure shock of it all, he felt like he wasn't even worthy to be called a son? There's people like that today. They grew up in church, but they drifted. They don't feel like they're worthy to be called Christians, to be called his. Come on. I don't think it took the son long to walk with his dad. The son at one point, he might have said anything to do with him. We can do all this, but I got to do that. Amen? And I believe the Holy Spirit will do that for people. So I just want you to be encouraged today that even when we're wayward, if we will return to his presence, there's a God waiting who has an abundant supply of mercy who wants to restore people. Amen? And as he does that, needs get met. It's just absolutely incredible. So maybe somebody's listening today in personal life and you're wayward and your world's a mess. God can make a message out of your mess that he can take care of and he can meet your needs. Amen? Are you with me, church? So not only that, we find this lady, there's a lady one time caught in the act of adultery. She learned that Jesus has an abundant supply of mercy to her. She found that out. Right? Israel, if we look at another example, they walked in unbelief and disobedience in the wilderness for an entire generation of people, but that never stopped God's presence from raining down bread from heaven and Chick-fil-A all day. I mean, it's just incredible. There's chicken biscuits, there's quail and heaven bread coming down. But there was the presence of the Lord there, wasn't there? There was a man there, wasn't there, named Moses. Come on, somebody. So I'm trying to tell some of you moms, some of you dads, some of you grandmas, some of you granddaughters, some of you aunts, some of you uncles. Keep on being the man of God. Keep on being the woman of God. Keep on praising him. Keep on praying. Keep on trusting. Keep on loving them. Love them through their wilderness. Amen? And don't stretch into 100 things. God's supplying them in these right now, and they're living wayward. God's doing something. They're not in the promised land. They're in the wilderness. Amen? Sometimes we get upset when we see people doing wrong and getting right. Don't understand. Don't be jealous. Don't be envious. They're in the wilderness. They're not in the blessed land. They're not in the land of milk and honey. Come on, somebody. Are you with me, church? And they decide to I got one more thing before I want to talk about the need. I want to talk about the healing. In Numbers chapter 21, I believe it is, the people of Israel were complaining against God and complaining against the man of God. So they complained against Moses. And so God got mad at him. He put him with a bunch of snakes. They got sick. And then people said, oh, Moses, we are so sorry. We We messed up. We apologize. We're sorry. We're sorry, God. But Moses goes and prays to God, and God says, make a bronze serpent, and everybody that got hit, they got sick, look at it, and they're going to receive the healing. It's just a really amazing, interesting story. Kind of you see that image today on medical things, won't you? And that's where it kind of came from. It's just so interesting that a bunch of miserable whiners, moaners, groaners, stiff-necked, fat-biting, gossiping, whining, complaining, unhappy with nothing people, God said, I'll heal every one of them. Because there's one that will stand in the gap. Oh, there's one who's still in the gap. His name is Jesus, but we need to stand in the gap. Amen. And so I just want you to know that maybe you feel like, man, I'm just going through something that's not financially, it's a physically, it's some other need, and I recognize that I've been wayward in an area of my life. Return to His presence. And in a twinkling of an eye, God can do more for you than you could try to do on your own. You receive that today? So the one end we've got, if we're obedient and faithful, we're going to experience God's presence in His presence. And another one, if we're wayward, we need to hear the voice of the Father saying, come home, come home, come home. How many times do you think the prodigal father, the father of the prodigal son, lay home at night and said, Father in heaven, please send my boy home? He might be dead, but I hope he's alive. Bring him home, and one day the prayer was answered. There are prayers waiting to be answered in our community. When we ask you to be a part of a dream team, all we have to do is thank you. But your community impact events. We don't just spend 10 cents on our community impact events. We just want to let them know we actually love them and that God loves them. But there's people out there that are just waiting for that prayer to be answered. And we don't know if their grandma that prayed that prayer is dead and buried and gone, but their prayer is still being echoed in heaven today. Amen. By dancing off with other loved ones. And so we need to just pray for them. So the altar invitation for this portion will be for the wayward to come to the Father. To step back into His presence, because if we'll step back into His presence, we will find restoration. We will find healing for our souls. We'll find healing for our bodies. If we step back into His presence, we're going to experience provision. Amen? So I just want to encourage you, because sometimes we feel like, well, I don't know, you know, all that faith and obedience, and we need that. We actually need to pursue that. That's our calling as followers of Christ. But I don't want people that are away from God to feel like that, well, I need to come and I need to jump through 1,000 hoops before God will bless me. No, the moment you return to His presence, He blesses you with the greatest thing ever. It's called restoration. It's called being saved in Jesus' name, or called recommitting your life to Jesus Christ. It's the greatest experience of mercy and grace that a person could experience. And so once God unleashed that, everything else is fair game. And if you don't believe it, listen to the following as a parable. He hired people at different times of the day. And the dude that he hired at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, he got paid the same as the guy that started at 7 o'clock. That's just I'm messing up the times there, I know that. But that's because that's just, and the people are like, what? That's just the God He serves. He's got so much provision, He's got so much mercy, He's got so much healing, He's got so many abilities just beyond our minds. So I just pray for those of you that feel a little wayward that today would be your homecoming. Let today write it down. What's today's date? The 29th? Yeah, January 29th, 2023. Today's my homecoming. Come home to His presence. If you're online, come home to His presence and let God just minister to you. Amen? Are you with me, church? I got one more thing to share with you. This will really encourage. I think it'll encourage all of us. Especially when I heard that in Florida, they just got the least amount of oranges harvested in 90 years. That just sounds because I like orange juice. I don't know if it's true. I heard it on the news. Don't judge me. Just say, I don't know. But here's what I want you to write down in your notes. I want you to get this into your spirit. Say this with me. God's ability to provide is above worldly supply chains. Did you get that into your spirit today? God's ability to provide is above every worldly supply chain in the world. I've never imagined in the industrialized wealthy nation of the United States of America that there would be supply chain issues. That you would go to Walmart and you couldn't find chicken wings when they're harvesting chickens by the truckload 10 feet away. Come on, somebody, that just don't make no sense. How many had a hard time competing that match? right? See birds all the time going over to Purdue, but then I go to the Walmart or the food line and ain't no chicken wings. Help a brother out. Come on now, that ain't right. We've seen shortages of toilet paper. You've got to be kidding me. This is just, but you see a lot of things in the world are man-made, and a lot of crises are man-made. But I serve a God that's beyond all of them. I serve a God that says, I'm bigger than every supply chain. Isaiah 55, we learn this, that God's thoughts and God's ways are higher than our ways. He just out of this world. I want you to think about this. In the wilderness for 40 long years, the children learned a valuable lesson from Moses. And the lesson from Moses was this. He was stubborn. He was absolutely stubborn. You know that he had commands of people that he did not organize. That said, the Rand McNally map said we ought to be going that way. And the Google News report says we ought to be going that way. Come on, somebody. And this news network said we ought to be going that way. And this person over here, this historian, said we need to go that way. And Moses simply said, if God doesn't move, we don't move. If the fire don't move, we don't move. If the pillar don't move, if the cloud don't move, we don't move. He was so stubborn, he said, we're in the wilderness, but I will not depart from his presence. Because as long as I and we are in the presence of God, worldly supply chains do not matter. You have to understand that there was no trucking route. There was no Cisco delivery system. Come on, y'all. There was no Amazon. There was no Wawa, no Rofo. There was no Krispy Kreme. There was nothing. There was no Texas. They were out there in the wilderness. Nothing. But God said, I will supply you water. I will supply you bread. I will supply you meat. I'll supply everything you need. And they learned a valuable lesson. Go where his presence is and stay with him. And as a result, even in a barren wilderness, the needs were supplied. Amen? So I guess that's just a miracle. It's an absolute miracle. And sometimes the presence of the Lord will instruct you. Like he said to the disciples, launch out into the deep and let down your net for a catch. These were professional fishermen in Luke chapter 5. They've been fishing all night and the supply chain was empty. But God said, don't worry, be obedient, stick with me and be faithful, launch out into the deep and put down your nets. If you read the story, they took two boats to gather the nets. It almost sank the boat. The supply was so much, it almost sank the boat. Can you fathom that? That would be like having more money in your banking account than the FDIC can insure. That would be like going from we can't find any chicken wings to my freezer is full. Come on, somebody. Are you hearing me? I'll tell you, this is the God that we serve. He is above every worldly supply chain, and sometimes we just need to listen to the voice of God and have a habit and a lifestyle of being obedient to Him, that even as you've been working all day long and tithing all your married life long, God says, I want you to do it again. I want you to give this. I want you to do that. I want you to step out of this. I want you to be a part of that. As you are faithful, God will begin to overflow blessings in your life and provide everything that you have need of because His supply chain is not subject to this world. His supply chain is out of this world. He said, watch and see if I won't open up the windows of heaven, pour out a blessing you can't even think, contain, or imagine. He's got supplies you don't even know about. Can I tell about your wallet, honey? Can I tell about that? Jennifer yesterday sent me this picture. I was over here praying over this place last night. Praying to be free from worry. I pray for supernatural provision over every seat and every place in this room. And she sent me a text. She said, because she likes to get different pocketbooks or wallets to go with the pocketbook. And then she got transfer stuff. Any other ladies do that? God is going to judge. You got fishing poles, guns, dogs, cars. So anyway, so she's doing it. And she said, look, I looked in his wallet. And there's some provision in here I didn't even know I had. Glory to God. There was money in a place where she didn't know there was no money. And it wasn't funny money. It wasn't monopoly money. It was real. In God we trust. Come on now. Money in there. I said, God's got provision, honey, that you don't even know about. He's got things set up in your life that you just don't. His supply chain is above every worldly supply chain. Can I get a witness in Jesus' name? Woo! Glory to God. I can't wait to find other ladies and go home tonight and check out their different purses and wallets and stuff and start testifying. My goodness gracious, I went to another church of God and there's money manifested in my wallet, but forgot about it. Praise the Lord. So I mean, God was like, honey, you need to go out and buy some more wallets right now. Jesus said, go buy some more. Lose. Now buy them and lose. Amen. Okay. Sometimes we've got to be like the little boy who offered up his lunch in the presence of the Lord. And then the Lord says, what you got for disciple? I just got some stinky fish. Bread is really not that great. Just real lunch. Boy over here, and here we go. I don't know what it is. We got 5,000 people, plus women and children. Good little man. 20,000 people here. She said, no problem. My supply chain is not subject to this world. My ability to provide, as long as the presence of the Lord is there, is above everything in this world. People are going to be blessed. I want to bless it. Now you take it and distribute it in small baskets and go out and distribute it amongst the crowd. Have to sit down and reach the 50, God's orderly. And they went and there's another bottomless bread basket situation. It was bottomless. It just kept going and kept going. And then they come back to Jesus and said, what you got? Well, we got like 12 baskets full of leftovers. This won't make much sense. As much as the world's supply chain right now doesn't make sense to me, and I studied economics, like my dad's the economist, I know many things are man-made and hype. Some things are real. I'm not worried. Because the systems of this world have never been my story. I serve a God who is far above this world. This earth is just his footstool. I've read the end of the book. And between God and man, he's going to take care of it forever and ever. He's got me covered. Amen? He will take care of our needs. His ability to rise above and beyond. I want you to remember this truth in Psalm chapter 23. Don't even hear this at funerals, but this isn't a funeral today. This is a celebration of life today. We're celebrating with the Lord. Amen? Psalm 23 begins with these words. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Or another translation, or a really good meaning of that word in the original language, and context is I shall not want. Can we just say that? The Lord is my shepherd. That's why I just began saying it softly. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I shall not want. And so the invitation for prayer here is going to be for God to demonstrate the truth to you that his ways are higher than your ones. His thoughts are higher than your thoughts. That his ability to provide needs is greater than any supply chain or system in this world. Sometimes we're tempted in this world to put all of our eggs in the basket of financial investment. And there's nothing wrong with that. Proverbs talks about that. But going to an extreme with the spirit of poverty, we can get into a hoarding mentality and never be a giver. And there will be times where our portfolios might not produce a return on the best we hope, might even lose money. But then the other time, where God said, I want you to go and deposit $10,000 to that person's life right now. Or $10. Or whatever God blesses on your heart. And if you're obedient to that, it's amazing the return on investment that God will turn your life. And it may be financial. Or it could be something different altogether. A provision that you've been praying for, that this world cannot supply, but God is continuously can. And I'll tell you, his ways are not our ways. And it all begins if we just stop working. Can we just stand together this morning?